Tonight, we're going to have a lightning panel.
Woohoo! That's why we got the album cover with the lightning!
That lightning panel is going to feature our own Andrew Robinson right there, Anna Carey, Clayton Parker, Steve Hodges, and Tony Drake. First question is, what is important to you when looking for a job? Who wants to, anybody want to grab that one? Somebody feel ready to kick us off today?
Oh, that's a good idea. Look at this guy. You should take over.
You should go first.
I'll introduce myself first. I thought it was better than... That's probably your first question, is who the heck are these people? My name's Steve Hodges. I write code all the time in Ruby. My job title is Director of Technology, but I'm now the lead guy at my company. So I'm a programmer, Director of Technology, and I write essentially crowdfunding investment software all the time, so it's a lot of fun. We're in a regulated space, so we get to deal with federal regulators that show up at our office. We can't wear the offensive t-shirts that day, and they come in suits and they're all official, but they're really impressed by walking into a startup where, you know, we haven't swept the floor all year, so that's me.
I'm Tony. I work at Springbuck as senior software engineer. We do healthcare analytics. Pretty much the best way I could describe it.
I'm Clayton. I work at Octiv. I'm the newly appointed DevOps lead there. And we're a sort of document generation and proposal generation service.
My name is Andrew. I feel like I might be a good change-up because I'm the one that doesn't write code every day. I know the codes, that's what we call them, right? But I don't do it every day because I spend most of my day leading the product and engineering team over at Lessonly. We write learning software for sales and support teams. We're trying to make their lives better. One lesson at a time. So that's why.
He's written a lot of code.
I have.
I've seen it. It was decent.
I'm Anna Carey and I work at
Hello? Yes. I'm Anna Carey, and I work at Mobi as a team lead senior software engineer, and I mostly just write code all day anyway for the performance team, and we are keeping track of all upgrades for the app, security. When we have time, we make it faster, but mostly we just try to stop the hemorrhaging or make it a little better.
Awesome. Hey, I got it working. I don't know what I did. I turned it off and turned it back on. Actually, I did the classic IT. All right, so our first question is, what is important to you when looking for a job? Steve, you seem maybe ready for this? No?
I was ready to introduce myself.
Oh, okay, you did a good job with that. All right, let's go.
I would say the most important thing for me is the team I'd be working with. I mean, to be basically living with these people 8 hours a day, so it's really important that you like the people you work with. So that's something I definitely look out for.
I'm just gonna kind of piggyback on that answer. I know I annoy the hell out of Miles when I get into my product speak, but in product land we like to have things that kind of match. So I have the four P's, right? So people, product, purpose, and process are the four things that I look for when looking for a job. And I took 7 months after one of my jobs about a couple years ago to ensure that I find the next right best fit. So that's why I thought about this so much. But anyway, people is by far and why the number one thing. People don't leave jobs, they leave bosses. So knowing who the boss is good. And checking out the profile, Twitter profile, LinkedIn profile of the people who are on the team, in my opinion, is super important. So just stealing your answer. And Sandy.
I'd piggyback on that to say culture, but not just like are the people fun to be around, but also culture in terms of like how fast do they move? Because one of the, I think there's a spectrum of like, and there's a job for the, each job has the right fit for it. Like, you know, if I'm working in a medical devices company, that's not a place I would be happy working because it's like, if I'm gonna have to fill out a change request rather than just like, I don't know, and, you know, pretty solid chance it'll work, let's try it out. Like this, I'm pretty far on the spectrum of just like, well, let's just give it a shot and see what happens, you know, and test the right amount. But I also think that culture can be like, you know, what am I expected to wear? Because I've, in my time at Moby, gotten rid of all of my business casual and then would have a hard time going back to like a must wear a button down sort of place. And also flexibility in terms of hours. Like I really like when, you know, you can just, you know, if you have to step out for an appointment, you make it up later. And that's, it's definitely something where, depends upon the size of your company, I think, whether that's a thing you can do or whether it's like, you know, you can be tardy. Like where I would prefer to be at a job where you get your work done and you can't be tardy.
I decided a long time ago that I have to like what I do in my job. We spend so many hours of our life working that if you don't enjoy it, or if you have the opportunity to enjoy it and you're not enjoying it, you're decreasing the quality of life. And I tell my wife this at home, she gets really mad at me because she has a really stressful job. And she doesn't get mad, she's glad that I'm really happy with what I do. But not everybody has that. So I appreciate that we're in an industry where a lot of us really do get to do what we like to do. So for me, it's being able to find somewhere where I can, if I want to code, I can code all the time if that's what I want to do. And I want to work on something that is, I at least am convinced is meaningful. And it just helps me have, I think, a more rewarding work, a more rewarding work life. So to me, it has a lot to do with just how I get to spend my day. You know, yeah, it comes down to people. I don't want to work with a bunch of assholes, you know? I mean, who does? Some people do, I guess. You know, having just that right balance. So. I'm not the kind of person that can take 7 months to look for a job. I tend to work while I'm employed, but
I was employed.
But you have to like what you do. So that is mostly what I look for. And that's really vague, but you know, I may walk in a place and interview and talk to people and say, you know, this isn't the right fit for me. Fortunately, there's a lot of opportunities and companies around this town, so
so what they all said, plus also being comfortable with the overall flow of day-to-day stuff. One thing you should always during an interview is to basically describe the day-to-day and how from idea to launch the flow of a feature would go. Because that also, while fitting in with the culture and doing stuff you like to do, it's can you work with that specific environment? I think a lot of devs don't quite think about that when they start looking for jobs. It's just grab whatever they want and then they just be lunged into a flow that just doesn't work for them.
So I really appreciate what you said there about asking about that during the interview. I was going to ask you guys as a follow-up to this question, related to this question, how do you find out when you're interviewing or looking into a job, what do you do to figure out if it's a right fit? So, Clayton, if you are trying to figure out if you're going to like the people at the place that you're interviewing, how do you find out if they're your type of people?
It's a great question. I don't have a great answer because I've never actually interviewed for a job.
Nice.
Probably the worst person to answer that.
But so that means you knew the people ahead of time.
Yeah.
That's an answer, right?
I guess so.
That's legit.
The current job I'm in, I was contracted before I started. So I was able to work with the team beforehand. And
That was definitely, gave them an upper hand when I was ready to move on.
No, I think a lot of people, especially engineers, we can be, if I can call myself we, we get jaded by things like LinkedIn. But if you look at, if you're about to interview for a position or maybe you have an offer, look at the people you know that are connected to the people in that team. They probably have some horror stories about that particular organization. So using your network, I think, is one of those underutilized tactics when it comes to finding out about the people on the team, because this is a really small town. I've worked with 30, 40% of the people in this room, so they got a lot of dirt on me. It's going to be, the longer that you're in this city, that you're in this town doing this work, especially in Ruby, you're going to know people who know people, and you got to use that to your advantage. So, I would just say use the network. LinkedIn is not, maybe it is the devil, but, you know, use it still.
I'd also say just the simple look around the room. So, like, I've done that before. You know, you walk in, you look around the room, and I've worked in companies where it was, let's see, about 45 people, and the only woman was a receptionist, and I should have just turned around and walked out, because that right there was a sign of the culture, and it was, like, I was 22 and got a hard time for not being married, and, like, there were just, it was a poor culture fit, and I should have known when I looked around the room that if there were 40 people in the room and no women doing anything other than answering phones, that it wasn't okay. And then Wise Garrett once told me that if you look around the room and you see any Dilbert cartoons, get the hell out. Because, or he probably didn't swear, but but he says that's a sign of depressed and frustrated workers or something like that. I absolutely agree that you can tell a lot just by looking at someone's work area.
There's two things I ask, and it's not necessarily related to the people question, but there's two things that I've asked in interviews that I found useful. One is kind of along the lines of what Tony was saying, what does the development process look like? But I get more selfish about it, it's all about me. What is my day going to look like, and what is it going to look like from my perspective, from my seat? How do you envision me helping bring a feature to market or fix a bug or whatever? And some people actually don't have processes, which scares me. But and then the other question I ask is about the product roadmap for the next year. And their answer to that, I can tell you a lot as well. They may not have a roadmap out past current month. Or you may actually learn about some pretty major features that you're going to be able to be a part of. I use that to dig in and get a real sense of the kind of challenges we'll be facing in the type of work.
Yeah, and then speak it demonstrated.
Way to call out my collection of Gilbert cartoons. I was just thinking about that. What was the question? That's all that's
happening. What's something you might ask in an interview or
well,
as you're learning?
I would say even before going in the interview, and this may sound odd or just sound very techie, is I slam their marketing site, their Twitter and their Facebook, and try to find every little bit of info I can about them. So when you walk into it, you can have an idea of what the company does and try to compare that with their sales pitch. If it doesn't match up, one, either their marketing's horrible or you don't understand it, or you're basically walking into something that doesn't really work for you. And I guess, you know, during an interview, like Hodges said, that, you know, what is the general flow and what are they working on is probably one of the other key things to figure out about them besides effectively what they do and what type of people they are.
Cool. Thank you, guys. I think that's about it for that question. But I thought that was really good. Our next question is related, but kind of from the other side of the table. I know you may not all be the hiring manager, but you're more than likely involved in one way, shape, or form in hiring and interviewing and that sort of thing and deciding who is on your team, right? So what is important to you when you're looking to hire or when you're hiring? Anybody want to start?
Now this part I've done a lot. I've read a bajillion resumes and interviewed a bajillion people. I say the first thing when I see a resume is please, please don't put a tech vomit at the beginning of your resume. No one cares that you spent 10 minutes on COBOL or something. Make sure that it's relevant to the job you're actually applying for. I've seen an inordinate amount of technologies listed on people's resumes, and I'm sure they don't know hardly any of them. I would also say, when you send a resume, please, for the love of God, don't send it in Word docs. That's the other thing. That is immediate trash can for me. If I see a docx or a doc file, I'm just like, sorry, you're out.
What if you sent it via Octiv?
That's right. Because maybe I should read it without
it. I know this is going to be relatively vague, but I would just say, give a shit. I'm serious. Engineering jobs for a lot of people, especially if you have a couple years of experience, is relatively easy to get a job, right? Because a lot of us are hiring. So I've seen these resumes that are clearly they spent a total of 5 minutes on the resume. Want to shout out to my man, and I know you're not at the Iron Yard anymore, but I've looked at a lot of the Iron Yard resumes, and they are beautiful, right? That ain't you, but whoever at the Iron Yard does that, thank you for that, because it's so refreshing to look at an Iron Yard resume as opposed to, somebody who has 50 spaces, so this is clearly just a conversion, a Word doc, but a poor conversion, and they don't, their LinkedIn profile is garbage. Their GitHub profile is garbage. You can't tell anything about them whatsoever. So my number one advice for if you're looking for a job is please, please, dear God, we look at so many of these things, just give a shit. So.
Yeah, I'd piggyback on that and say when we were filtering for interviews, there was a pile where we weren't going to take more than a quarter of them. So the first thing that we did was just look at reasons to hate on these people. If they misspelled something I'm trying to think of the worst examples now, but they were like the Javas or something like that. Where it's just something like that where if you say you know the Javas or whatever it is, no. You go right to the trash. But also just... Oh, yeah. Something like that, one of those and you're done. Because I found in my years of interviewing that the one thing that really tanks people, or the one fireable offense that seems to happen over and over again for programmers, is not inability, but arrogance. So if someone is... assesses their ability at far beyond what it actually is and wants you to know that they're great when in matter of fact they're good in learning. Good in learning is fine. Thinking that they've made it and they're great and they, they're just fine the way they are and they're a gift for being there is not something that you can teach. So I would say that, and my interviewing tip would be if you can get someone talking about something that they love, then you've made it. If you're what's the favorite thing you've made? And then you get the whole interviewing team talking and you don't have to say much, they feel good about what they're talking about and they just remember being happy and then you didn't have to really impress them. You could impress them, but you can just kind of sit back and be like, hey, we had a really fun conversation.
I would say, especially for people just starting out that have no experience, the easiest way to replace the lack of experience is any side project you can scrounge up, either during college or just on the side or whatever, doing random freelancing or even just your web developer just jokes, or not joke sites, but just websites that no one will really ever go to. Maybe they just don't even launch or is just on a random Heroku subdomain just to show that you can do something. Because if you look at that resume and you have, I do these languages, I went to this college, these are my projects, that tells you nothing. But if I have at least a GitHub repo with actual side projects that's not class projects, that goes a long, long way when you're starting out. When I first started out, I basically had nothing besides the college degree, but I also had a couple side gigs I did. I freelanced for a couple small businesses way back in the day. It was hell, but it was at least something to put on the resume to get basically other people's attention to make me stand out amongst everyone else that also had no experience.
This is kind of a tough question for me because first, my company isn't hiring for me, but depending on the size team you're hiring for, I think the answer is varied. But one of the things that really stand out to me with a candidate is other technologies they work on in their free time. So whether that's somebody that likes to mess around with Raspberry Pi or Arduinos, or is really passionate about their drone in a non-creepy way, and likes to try out the new language or a new gem or something just in their spare time. I'm not someone that has a ton of spare time. I have kids. I have a lot going on outside of work. But there are side interests and things that kind of keep me a little bit more current. And it shows to me it's this curiosity that they're willing to learn, that they can do something outside of their comfort zone. Those are all things that I look for as maybe substitutes for experience, as you mentioned, or just to get a better sense of something.
So for the rest of you, what's...
I would just totally agree with those points. If you send a resume and it doesn't have a GitHub link on it, that's kind of a minus one in my opinion. Especially if you have decades of experience and you've never put anything on GitHub or forked anything or anything, there's like nothing there. That's just kind of weird.
So that's an instant negative one. What's something like the non-creepy drone passion? That might be just a plus one or intriguing at least, like as you're looking through a resume or looking into someone or even talking to someone, what's something where you're like, I want to know more about this person, like that. The thing they just said or wrote down there is interesting. And if you just have like one example, that's cool. If you have a pattern, that's also cool.
I know this is relatively difficult to do, but I won't call out names, but there was one person in the room who I immediately fell in love with, mainly because they had open source projects out there that other developers were using. And I know that's very difficult to do, I get that. But putting it out there for people to use or contributing to an open source repo, as many resumes as you look through, especially when you're doing the intense type of hiring that we're doing right now, that type of thing is like, okay, I must know this person. I absolutely must know this person because they're writing something that other engineers get to see every day. And that's there's very, very little like that, other than maybe a project that you can go to, click around, and they did the work for it. That's pretty awesome too, but an open source project is pretty badass.
I think this is more of an entry level tip, but I always like it when someone just puts anything interesting on the resume. Like, when you get a stack of more than 10 and you, like, somehow the names become boring, but like the person who speaks Russian or the, like, there's always something on the list that should stand out. But if you're like, especially when you're going through IUPUI internship resumes, where like everybody can be completed almost the same courses. And like, we're like, they all kind of sound the same. So if you put in just anything to make you memorable, like I keep on coming back to thinking about the resume that was on the internet recently that was like, epic My Little Ponies, but also an amazing set of qualifications. Like, that's ballsy, and it's gonna filter out the places where you don't belong, but also just like anything. Like, give me two conversational starters when we want some small talk other than like, so tell me about yourself, because that's not so fun.
A quick, I'm sorry, I'm going to interject myself for a second. A quick cautionary tale on that. I heard a story once, someone was interviewing someone else out of state, so this happened elsewhere. So nobody in this room or even in this community was involved. And the resume had said, I'm on a mission to find the best burrito, something like that. And they're like, man, tell us about this mission to find the best burrito. And the guy was like, I don't know, I really like burritos. And they were expecting, you know, it was a programmer, right? So they were expecting, like, I bet he's got a spreadsheet. And, like, he's been ranking burritos for probably years at this point, right? So, like, at least be prepared to talk about it, right?
And this may be me, although some people may also share this opinion. Ninjas, wizards, Jedis, they were cool in 2011. Don't call yourself that on a resume.
Were they?
Well, it was keywords that some companies looked at for hiring, but back when, you know, all the hipsters learned how to program. Of course, I'm speaking generally.
Anybody else want to say anything on this topic?
On the looking to hire topic, I kind of already answered that previous question, but one of the things that I ask people that have worked, actually at a job somewhere, whether it's an internship or, you know, they have a lot of experience, is I ask them about, not necessarily directly their job, their skill set, their experience, but the development processes of their previous jobs. And you get a lot of different answers, but you can really start to get a lot out of someone and kind of figure out what they like, what they didn't like, what worked for them, maybe even why they didn't work out and left. But there's a lot of different aspects you can ask about their previous job. You know, clearly you can ask, what did you do? What did you write? What kind of, you know, what was your favorite project? But just different things about their environment can help tease out a lot of the expectations they have for you know, what their good work environment is going to be. So you may find that someone gets, you know, huge waterfall approach. I don't know. There's a lot of things you can get out of people by asking this.
I would say always trust your gut when you're looking to hire. We once, the previous company, we once hired a guy who created his own text editor and was using it to do daily development. And I was like, that's kind of weird. It's a little over the top. And that was just a predictor for really bad things to come. So I should have gone without gut feeling and just said, no, that's the worst thing possible.
Right, because it wasn't Ben.
It wasn't Ben.
Right.
It wasn't even Clinton. And when we hired him, he would make fun of him. And I was like, ooh.
Yeah.
What about this guy?
Let's see the next question here. The next question, what code lesson could you have learned early in your career that would have saved you a ton of pain?
Always remember the where clause in your update statements. but seriously, I would say, well, yeah, that was a long, long weekend to fix that. On a serious note, I would say, not knowing to ask why as often as you should. As a junior dev, you're commonly, not so much marching orders, but you're just kind of given work to do. And the more you dive into a company, you may start asking, why are we doing it this way? Or why is this request specifically like this? Shouldn't it be like X instead of Y? Stuff like that. Eventually, it helps you open your eyes and forces you to think of stuff in a different manner, basically. Obviously, you don't want to, you know, say, scream no, 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 and push back really hard. But I guess try to get a better overall picture of what it is you're doing there, as opposed to just following the ticket or whatever.
So, I worked with a really smart guy. Most of the time, he was a smart guy. And no, he's not in the room. In fact, I don't think he's worked with anyone. But
that's right.
I do know plenty of smart people in this room, but he chained 8 enumerable methods in a row online. And he started with a tap, and then did an active record where, and then after that did an enumerable select, selected all the objects with an amount greater than 0. Then he mapped to get all the amounts. And then he did an inject plus. And for the longest time I skipped over this line of code because I didn't care about the method, it never broke. And you know, it did work. But I was going through and cleaning up some performance issues. And I found this line of code and I actually decided I was going to read it and figure out what it did. And I figured out that we're all drinking beer here, so I can say this is after hours. That motherfucker didn't know about song. Dude had a master's degree. He didn't know about song. He'd been writing Rails or Ruby for many years. And I'm pretty sure he's looking for work right now. My lesson that I learned a long time ago is read the docs. Whenever a new version of Ruby's released or you hear about some method that you didn't know about that sounds interesting, I tend to go to the docs for that class and look and say, hey, there's a method I never knew about that could have solved that would have been really useful. And this has been true ever since I first started hacking away back when PHP was a newer thing. A lot of the problems that we try to solve, summing numbers, is something that a lot of people tend to have needed in the past. So the language, especially a language like Ruby that has a lot of syntactic trigger and whatnot, probably has it in there. So my advice from early in my career would be to read manual. My advice to anyone that works with this guy is to not.
I would say one thing I learned and I wish I had learned it much earlier. In a former life, I was a Python developer, and Python has this thing called the Zen of Python. And one of the tenets is flat is better than nested. And I'd always, read through it and I was like, yeah, that sounds good. But I never really thought to apply it in any way. And one day I was on Stack Overflow and Alex Martelli, who's one of the core contributors to Python, was answering a question and described that tenet in an answer. And I was like, it just blew me away. I was like, oh my God, what have I been doing this whole time? If you're writing a method or some bit of code, and you start an if statement, and then everything inside of that I don't know if anyone's ever seen the people making fun of PHP with the rhyme, all the conditionals that go down and then there's the plane going through that. If you ever find yourself writing that type of code, you can usually bail out really without having to get into each one of those ifs, getting deeper and deeper and deeper. And it makes code so much more readable when you do that. So I've seen a lot of junior engineers fall into that trap. Luckily, I've helped him get out of that, and myself, I've cleaned up tons of code.
So this one's a little more cliche, but often when I was a rookie engineer, I was like, I gotta go fast, man. I know what I'm doing. I gotta go fast. So testing, that's for the weenies. You know what I'm saying? Like that's I don't have time for that. As I've gotten older, Sandy Metz actually has a quote that Les, one of the guys, taught me recently, which is shameless green. So I know that's a test-driven development thing and saying that rookie engineers should respect tests and maybe give test-driven development a try is a little cliche, but I wish somebody would have smacked me over the head and say, no, you're not going fast, you're just breaking shit. The shameless green, what that means is, write the test, do whatever it takes in the code to get that test to turn green, and then have the wherewithal to go back and clean that code up, right? But that doesn't mean to try to make it perfect right out of the get-go. That doesn't mean hack like crazy and just get it out there. That means get to green and then intelligently work your way to the point where it's just right. You know, that doesn't mean over engineering. So from a code standpoint, I would say testing is important.
I'd say one of the most painful things in my career has been working on utterly useless code. That's happened twice where I've had the entire project of over 6 months be utterly useless and never used. And in hindsight, I now have the maturity to recognize when a project is completely and utterly hopeless. And either, you know, try really hard to make it not hopeless, or just recognize when it is and move on. One of them, they decided that they didn't want to commit to a particular database or a particular schema even. So the thing that they did is they just stored all of the XML in the database so that you could parse it every time. That one, I mean, there's no fixing that without burning it with fire, the whole app. And they thought they were so clever with their XML transformations. And so I kind of want to just say quit earlier. Like, that one was utterly hopeless. And then the project where in order to speed things up, we were going to swap out the database layer and serialize everything to JSON and make it a service because the database was slow. And I knew before I wrote a single line of code that was not a worthy goal. And I fought hard, and then they told me it was the problem was my attitude. And I should have admitted defeat way earlier and just left. And they bless their hearts. It worked for it was live in production for a few hours before someone said, you know what, this is not better. Surprise.
Awesome. I really like that question. I want to put more in it, but I think we're going to move on. I'm actually going to skip the very next question because I know that this question was important to someone who actually might not be in the audience, but it might be important to some others of you as well. When do you open source your code, and how do you keep up managing it? My current answer to this is try to get Dave Jones involved. But I bet there's a better answer than that. I don't know that I know the answer. Who here would like to tackle this one?
Early? I mean, I think you have to write code with the intent of sharing it from the very beginning. So if you're going to do it, you might get over your embarrassment and just put it out there. Like, there's no too soon. I mean, you can just put in the README, I am working on a thing that doesn't do much yet, and go from there. I think otherwise you just won't get around to it.
I would say only when you have a decent generic case. At least with my experience, everything I've open source was based off of something in my professional career that I found. I eliminated most of the business logic out of it into something generic, to something that anyone could effectively use, as opposed to this one very specific thing that the company uses. Or similar to what Anna says, just start tinkering on just a repo with an idea you have. It may pan out or it may not. But it does try to keep stuff as general as possible, because you always run into edge cases, and if your library can't really handle it, it doesn't become too useful if it can't handle most cases, pretty much. And how do I keep up with it? I am undateable, so I have a lot of free time.
So I'm not gonna directly answer the question because
oh good, great.
You know, I want to make up my own question, Miles.
Okay.
So when you're on a team, I think it's kind of two things. Number one, it'll tell you a little bit about the culture of the team if the leadership recognizes the benefits of the efforts of open sourcing some of the code that the team is writing. You know what I'm saying? Like, that is, I think, a positive for a team overall, that the leadership understands the life of engineer and understands some of the things that you know, we just take for granted, you know. Second thing, it's also architecturally, kind of to Tony's point, not that I'm dating the piece, but the earlier pieces, when he was talking about more of the, making it more generic, it's a, you know, it's not always a good pattern to be able to have something be able to be extracted from your primary code base, but it's a good architecture pattern. I think oftentimes if you challenge yourself, well, what in this could I pull out and make into a thing in and of itself? And if you have a culture of open source on a team, you can run into those scenarios more often. And even if you don't make it public to the world, and I'm not talking full-fledged microservices or anything like that, but if you just think about it differently, I think you oftentimes will come up with better architecture. So it's a thought exercise that I think is good to have individually and on the team. So sorry for not answering the question.
I would say a good time to open source some code is when you're talking with your teammates and saying, oh, we'll open source that later. That's the perfect time to do it, because you're never going to do it later. And keeping up with it, I think to Miles' point, it's having someone else help. Maintaining an open source library by yourself, especially one that's popular or widely used, is difficult, very difficult for one person. And I'd say when you do, make sure that you don't be scared to tell people about it, because I'm sure there's a lot of pull requests that come through that, you know, don't really make sense or too complicated, or for whatever reason, you know, don't be shy and just merge that code. Make sure you're, you know, the owner of that code. I have some open source libraries and I've been pretty poor at keeping up with them because I'm the only person that maintains them. So it's definitely.
Sort of related thing is when you do need to fork a repo, you're obviously forking it because you need to change some functionality. That is, I think, the most obvious time to contribute that back. Spend a little bit more time if you can, if it makes sense for that project, and maybe sticking the business logic in there for longer. But that's probably the first time that I contribute open source. I do try to follow the pattern. Everything that goes in my lib folder should be able to be extractable. And I think that's the case, but I don't have the time to open source all this stuff. I could probably get it out there. I mean, actually, that's the biggest hurdle. The libraries that I have turning into a gem of open source, you know, going through that process improved that library quite a bit. I wrote better tests. I actually documented it. In addition to being self-documented. I like to give very simple examples for how to use that code. So, you know, instead of modeling something in our domain, I'll go model, you know, a house has many rooms which may have curtains, you know, something like that. And when you actually start working in your domain, it gets you thinking about it a little bit differently. And I actually found that my libraries cleaned up quite a bit when I going through that process takes time. So I would agree that the moment where you think I should do it is probably the time where you should try to take a weekend and do it, or try to take you know, a few evenings. And as far as keeping up with it, you know, that code is another part of my primary project at work. So when I need new features, I need to make changes. It's the primary time when I go and publish to that repo. But also, you know, whenever there's a new major release of Linux, for instance, make sure it still works. Add conditions in there for kernel versions if you need to do that sort of thing. And then, you know, responding to pull requests. And I don't have anything that gets a lot of pull requests, but if you're timely with that, of course, you can get back into the project and context switch and figure it out. So that's sort of how I do it.
Awesome. Thank you. At this point in our lightning panel, we're going to get a little bit more technical. with things. So the question is, what is your favorite non-standard pattern to apply to a Rails project? If we assume that standard is model view controller helper, there are lots of them out there, form objects, type creators, services, interactors. Well, you know, some people may not know what those mean or how you should use them. So what is your favorite or maybe or one that you've created or whatever?
I would say service objects or just generic Rails Ruby classes to help stuff out. I would say I try to keep controller actions as small as possible. If there's a lot of logic and a lot of things that need to happen, I commonly will shove it off into a helper class when possible. I'm getting active record objects, I'll just pass those through as arguments and just call a action or do it method that does a lot of the stuff I needed to do. I find that a little bit easier to test than possibly setting up a controller test. Although, you can pretty much kill two birds with one stone with having a controller test that calls your helper class that does all the stuff so you have all that coverage, as well as understand the, you know, the result that comes out of the web request. But yeah, I would say helper classes pretty much.
There's a couple, you know, the gang of four patterns that I use. You know, this, the conversation about object-oriented versus functional programming, maybe statelessism is popular now, but I use state machine quite a bit versus states, just because it really fits a lot of the things in the domains that I work in. So, you know, that pattern is generally, depending on the state, your object behaves in different ways. You can kind of model the world around that a lot of different ways. Like this cup, the state is empty, and that means Lynn's beer is true. So, you know, states is a common one that I use in my day job. Form objects are another one. If you're not familiar with the form object pattern, instead of submitting your, you know, your controller reads params and then it goes and updates some objects in your database, example Rails magic. But you know, we at in my day job have dozens and dozens of ways you can update a business generic object, right? A super object. So can't get away from it now. So but it, you know, we use form objects. So if you're submitting your form in a certain context, trying to, I don't know, update their profile or something like that. Like, you only be updating a certain number of parameters, so for, you know, Rails, strong parameters and that type of thing, you can automatically scrub those params. You can go into validations there in an individual object instead of having all of your validations in your record model. Helps keep your model slimmer, and we ton of validations from our business model and really fraud. So it's one that I like. I think I got turned on to it by seeing that presentation at this conference a few years ago, and it changed my life.
I'd say the only one I really had experience with, well, two, I guess, the one I've had experience with was is the interactor pattern, kind of what Tony was saying, like getting that logic out of your controller and putting it in a place that's sort of easier to test. Is one thing I've used. I'm sort of still new to Rails, so I'm sort of legacy code base, so I don't have a lot of greenfield development.
And I'm kind of presenting myself as the code adjacent guy, the guy who is encoding every day, so I didn't know that every question is going to go to everybody.
But
no, it's all good. It's all
I'm
good.
Not sorry.
And this is a relatively old school pattern, mostly from my .NET days. I've tried to implement it in Ruby a couple times, but when you're in code bases with people who are very opinionated, Sometimes they will give you shit about it. But anyway, the factory pattern in its derivatives, oftentimes, you know, especially when I was starting out, the super fat models and even fat controllers, you know, that was all the rage. But as you start to break that down more and more and more, there will be times when you have an object that isn't necessarily tied to the database, and even if some of them are tied to the database, when you're about to create it, using the factory pattern, which is basically just a method that will generate an object in very specific ways based on the parameters that you pass in. And it's not really a super complicated design pattern, but it's one that I used to use a lot in the past. I don't know if the kids are using them today, but my old ass man still uses them.
Maybe
me in the code base.
And if you don't have a specific question, I actually have a question for you that is related, if you're interested. I'll be kind of putting you on the spot.
Okay.
But with your experience doing performance-related things at OB on a large code base, are there patterns that you've seen applied or misapplied such that they've caused huge performance concerns that you've had? So, do you feel like there are some patterns that can be avoided or maybe applied more better?
Our worst performance offenders seem to be the things that people wrote in Rails 2.3 and then like they iterate over all of the things because bless their hearts, that's all they had at the time. We have gotten around to it. Like those are our worst offenders. Or the worst patterns where you're like, you get a bunch of stuff and then you like just select on it and then you know you might add stuff from over here to the stuff from over there and then you're like, shit, now I have to sort this, like, and probably, I mean, it's just got, the logic has gotten so complicated. I saw like a thing that was going to be get all the kind of objects that is one kind of object, like to figure that method together, and I just was like, well, I'll just look away. Because otherwise this is going to be a day of work to test all the permutations of this. Because in the beginning I was like, shit, why are they sorting in the view? This is terrible. And then I just closed it and walked away. I don't know. There's a lot of things we have going on. Lots and lots.
So bigger code base is like 8+ years old now, right? So
something like that, yeah. Maybe even older.
It's got like real history and stuff.
Oh yeah. And there's a lot of it. It makes a lot of sense, and you have to be forgiving because 8 years ago, someone's like, I'm gonna throw some code out there and hope we have a business. And so they wrote code that was good enough for now, and we left it. So, that's
okay. Awesome. Last official question of the panel. Yep. I think this is a more fun one. It can be a more fun one. I think even Andrew will probably have one that he used a lot when he was still one of us pleb coders, right? What gem do you keep returning to time and time again? Long-lived, super useful, perhaps under the radar, doesn't have to be under the radar type of thing. Something that you feel like you've been using for a decade.
Rescue. Most new developers coming in, when they say, I need a background job, everyone goes to everyone. Sidekick.
Distributed Ruby.
Or that. I try to always push Rescue, especially with a few of my other side projects. Sidekick's great. However, a wise man once told me Sidekick is for organization, Rescue is for chaos. Every day we deal with chaos. And Sidekick doesn't handle chaos very well. It likes stuff very small, very neat, very organized. And unfortunately, typically the real world is not that. Rescue, similar to Unicorn, can take a beating and clean up after itself. because it's forking as opposed to threading like Sidekick is in Puma. So I always have that in my back pocket, especially if you, for whatever reason, may have a long-running job that takes more than 10 seconds, like 10 hours. And you obviously can't kill that because Sidekick will just retried and, oh crap, that code accidentally changed global state and everything else is screwed up and oh god. So I always like coming back to rescue if I have the option to do so. And they can run side by side as well, which is nice. I'm not going to tell you in a long time.
There's two. One's a really small one that I think actually is now, it's been incorporated into Haml. It's called Haml's Comments. And I know that this isn't really, it's just where I got it. Actually, the guy wrote it. Okay. But if you view your source of your rendered HTML, it includes comments where all of your partials start and stop. And if you're doing front-end work and trying to figure out where the hell that text came from, being able to inspect element in Chrome and see HTML comments that say, this came from this exact partial, saves you a lot of time. So I like that one. I do think that's in the administration panel, though. So, and then the other is one that I throw at a lot of my side projects. It's called Active Admin. And I've used Active Admin and leaned on it quite a lot in the past few years to the point where I've outgrown it and had to replace it. But it's great for new projects. It basically gives you instant CRUD for any of your models. So you have, you just, with no configuration practically, you just say, I want an Active Admin controller basically for business. And you just basically say, I want business, and it gives it to you. And you have full CRUD on the entire model. And an index and searching and all these things. Now, it's really stupid. It causes N plus one errors like crazy unless you use it properly. However, those don't matter when you're working on a side project for yourself. Or if you know how to use it properly. And it really is nice when you're doing a lot of as many throughs, as belongs to many relationships, because it builds forms for those with no effort. So it saves a ton of time. Something I probably, you know, an interface I could spend a week on in my day job is done immediately by this job. So that's a pretty
cool one. We use and probably use quite a bit at Octiv is Localstake. Super powerful. Can do all kinds of crazy stuff. It always seems to surprise me with the features and things it can do. So that one we use a ton. We do a lot of document processing, dealing with XML or HTML, so that makes it a breeze and actually kind of a delight. Another one, which is definitely not under the radar, that I use almost every day is Pry. If you don't use Pry, I would say you're a loser. Sad.
So have you heard about this thing called Pry? No, I don't even know if the other one, my backup one, just in case someone said Pry.
What is Pry?
I come from the .NET space, so I had breakpoints inside of Visual Studio. When I got to the Ruby world, it was actually at DevTown. They made fun of me all the time from the fact that I relied so heavily on the IDE from before. And I didn't have breakpoints anymore. So I'm like, how do you know what this code is going to do, right? Like, I need to be able to stop here. So what Pry does is you put binding.pry in a location and it'll stop. So if you have your server running, you go to a page, you put binding.pry in a method where you want to see what's going on there because there's a bug going on there. You can put Pry there and you can inspect all the different elements in that particular method. So. Thank you for asking that, for saving me. yes. Yeah. One that I don't know, I used to use, and I think Rails ActiveRecker specifically has gotten more sophisticated since back then, but Squeal? Anybody remember Squeal? Squeal's still a thing? Anyway, I used to love Squeal because I love SQL, and ActiveRecker back in 2014 didn't have like not in and not or and that type of stuff. So Squeal had all that, and I hate, what is it, Arl? DevOps is shit, man. They don't hate on Spill. But then my last one I'll say is pundit for authorization purposes. Role-based access is an important thing, and you know, it's a thing that most apps wait on until it's too late, and then you have to refactor so much. But if you do something like pundit right from the beginning, policy-based access control, I'm pro pundit.
I don't know how obscure it is, but I really like Rails panel when I'm doing performance work. It's just like all the other Chrome tools, and it adds in another tab. It's essentially all the things that are in the log, but in a format where you can actually read it and sort it. So like, I might just load a page and see what the worst performing query is, or how long certain partials take. It's just nice to have the information well organized. I also like bullet to either you can either have the footer, like you can add a footer on the page, or you can add it in the log or whatever, but it'll show you, maybe not all, but many of the N plus one queries on your page. HIRB, gives you your, like if you were going to do, like return, five rows from a model or something like that, it'll put it in a tabular form, so a lot of times that's nice.
Awesome. Anna, Andrew, Clayton, Steve, Tony, thank you very much. Please, a round of applause.